Thank you for the introduction. Thank you for this conference and the possibility to speak here. And I found a book on my bookshelf before I went off the trip. And I think Peter Farago gave it to me some years ago, former director of FOS from Switzerland. And it's called Facing the Future. And I think it was the final edition of sort of the predecessor conference of this one. And what I found from a first glimpse that it seems that the research infrastructures have really matured and gone forward, because it's very much focusing on how to cooperate at all, and many technicalities, and that we are here speaking about impact, I think shows that some of the basic questions how to do this European research infrastructures have been solved, and not all of them, but there is room to do something new and to take the next steps forward. So what is this being recorded? Okay. Well, well, it starts with the very trivial fact that we are a very new ministry. Since 8th of January, we are in a new composition after our elections, and we don't have a corporate identity yet. So this is a temporary thing, and I could freely, you know, do the presentation however I wanted to do it in terms of its looks. I want to talk about the demand for SSH research infrastructures. I will quickly do a sidestep on demand for SSH research in general, but I think we all agree on that and should focus on the research infrastructures here. Then I will bring some insight from a project that a colleague of mine is currently doing within the ministry on research infrastructures. And then I will give some input from my experience working in the General Assemblies of ESS, SHARE, SESTA, and also from the S3 Strategic Working Group. So many of the things I will present are rather my personal views and personal experiences in this field. I looked upon the question of demand, or I will be looking on it from two angles. One is scientific demand, and the other one is the societal demand. And in fact, I will the transition from scientific demand to societal demand will become quite obvious with this very rough data I took from this project of my colleague. But let's do this quick sidestep to demand for research on SSH research in general, because I think it's a very important moment in time right now as the European Commission is preparing the next framework program. And I did a small policy brief, also in a personal capacity, but it was put on the official Austrian European Research Area portal. So my view was that, of course, research on society and culture should be at the heart of the next framework program. That's quite, I think, a very high goal, which will be very hard to achieve. But in Horizon 2020, the big new thing was SSH integration. And we have some numbers that show that SSH integration is not working very well. So in the Commission document, the analysis is called, we have an unequal or highly uneven results. The Austrian Research Promotion Agency put it more bluntly in their analysis and said it's not working. And I think we have to continue with SSH integration. It's very important. But we also need, of course, a research stream or a funding stream for research on society and culture as such. And one of the arguments is that the biggest challenges for Europe are exactly in economic fields, in political fields, in social fields, and just put on the slide a list of biggest challenges according to citizens from the Eurobarometer from 2016, and I think most of them can clearly not be analyzed by natural science disciplines. So I think this is the argument why there should be a big role for research from these disciplines, although of course the next framework program will not be a disciplinary program. And I have put there a link to the Simulac project. 2,000 European citizens were asked what kind of research questions they would like to see research on. And the general result was they would like to see research on health and on society. So, I mean, everyone wants to have research on health, less sickness and all these questions. But the other big questions were clearly SSH research questions. And one more thing I would like to add here, that I think it's very important that research infrastructures think about how they can contribute to the missions in FP9. This will be this new format. No one really knows what it will be or what it will look like, but it's something new, and it means that there should be a clearly measurable and communicable target that should be achieved, like, for instance, the end of plastic. I think this is something research infrastructures have to think about. So coming to the question of demand for research infrastructures, I will directly jump to the project, because I think this will clearly go in the direction to discuss this aspect. The project was done by my colleague Thorsten Barth, and the aim was to analyze the use of international research infrastructures by Austrian institutions in this period from 2013 to 2018, and the analysis should support decision making in negotiating the performing contracts with Austrian universities. And it's quite a hands-on project. It doesn't really have a very sophisticated theoretical basis. And it's simply using numbers you quickly and easily have access to. But when you have to take decisions, that's very often the thing you do, even though you know that this might be very rough indicators, but still, that's what people do. And yeah, the project is not finished, and although it's an internal project and will not be published, I can share these preliminary results. Because when we negotiate it with the universities in practice, actually it will become public. So, 70 international organizations with research infrastructures are currently used by Austrian research organizations, and 24 of them, the participation is with involvement of the ministry, so basically it means that the ministry is paying the participation in these organizations, and they are across all scientific domains. And they use the term research infrastructure organizations here because some organizations run several very different research infrastructures. So for instance, CERN, the EMBL, Electra, they have several research infrastructures running under one roof. And the scientific domains show that most of the these organizations are in the field of physical science and engineering, but in the social and cultural innovation part, there are also quite a number. This lotus flower It's basically the network of institutions using research infrastructures in these different scientific domains. It's an overview of all institutions. And it shows that research infrastructures are really about networks. And this is the piece from the social and cultural innovation domain. And you see that on the first glimpse, many institutions are using these research infrastructures. And this is, at first glimpse, a good sign. And it's supporting a little bit our theory why we are also supporting research infrastructures, that they should be points of crystallization. So where communities come together, that is basically what it means. And in the end, even school building is happening. But I think we have to ask the question if this is really happening by itself. I think some of the research infrastructures, they provide data, they produce data, but you need additional activities, you need specific activities to also start these communities, this working together on a common research subject, because just by running the research infrastructure, this is not happening by itself. So this is an easier overview of the five international research infrastructures. Austria is participating in the social sciences and humanities. And what this picture simply shows is that the most important universities are participating in them, and also some other, especially the Academy of Science. So this is the most important thing. But actually what is important in this chart is the second last column, which shows other participants. Because for this internal project, my colleagues only looked at the sample from universities, the Academy of Science, and a few other non-university research institutes for practical reasons, because that's the institutions we are directly negotiating funding with. But for SSH research infrastructures, this category other is very important, and I will come in a few moments to this. What I also wanted to say is that, and this is a similar approach like also Klaus Schindel from the German ministry said, that some of these fundings are starting fundings, and we look that institutions also take over their part of funding research infrastructures. And for us, it's very important that many different institutions use a research infrastructure, because if only one institution would use a research infrastructure, then it would be rather the responsibility of the certain institution to fund it. So just like biologists have their laboratories or the veterinarians have their rat colonies or physicists have machines, social scientists should get access to surveys and humanists should get research infrastructures in their field. But if there is use of one research infrastructure by many different institutions, this is a clear argument to step in for funding there, because then the added value for the national research area is given. But I wanted to come back to this last column, other users. This is really important, and this leads now to the societal demand for SSH research infrastructures. SSH research infrastructure users go beyond universities and academies of sciences. So you saw figures around 10 institutions using these research infrastructures, and this is of course not all of them in Austria that actually do use them, but they are from quite a different field than universities or academies. So for instance, SHARE in Austria has around 30 further institutional users. that were not included in the previous sample, but we know that they do have these uses. They are non-university research organizations with very specific foci. They are ministries, local government, and also NGOs. When you look at the uses of the European Social Survey, there are 170 individual uses from NGOs, so we don't have it broken down in the number of institutions, but clearly it's a lot of users not from the university sector. The same figures are, we see similar indications for the gender and generation survey, where also users come from non-university research organizations, government and NGOs, and the service provider for SESTA, the Austrian Social Science Data Archive, has been founded with the clear agenda to have impact not only on science, but also on society from the very beginning. So we gave them the mission to also make data available for the use in education, in schools, and also for data journalism. So these are user groups they are not so comfortable with yet, and they don't know how to really develop. They haven't yet here, but it's still, it needs to develop the right data sets for them and the right mechanisms to provide data to these communities. Other clear indicators for the societal demand for research infrastructures are the Austrian funders, actually, because it's not only the Ministry of Science that is funding research infrastructures, but in Austria it's also the Ministry of Labour, Social Affairs, Health and Consumer Protection. They are co-funding SHARE and the European Social Survey. And we see also a growing use of data from ESS and SHARE in the Austrian media. And I think this is another indicator for demand from society. So with this description, I wanted to give some figures from this small project, but I wanted to quickly discuss or give some ideas how to further create demand. And this input comes from Frank Sposito. He is one of the people working at the Austrian Social Science Data Archive, and he recently gave a presentation in Austria on the question of reuse and asking basically the question if research infrastructures are asking too much from the users and giving them too little. So they are basically producing data and providing data, but are they thinking enough of data reuse? That's what was his sort of maybe provocative hypothesis. And he's also cited Parsons and Dürer that scientific data preservation is pointless unless the data is used. This is not so surprising, but still it's something that has to be thought about. And what this slide basically showed was that he said earlier, when one person had a data set, he would talk to someone else and say, you know, I have this interesting data set. Are you interested in using it? Or it was rather the other way around. Someone said, you know, I've heard you have this data set. Can I have a look at it? And they talked about it. They shared the data set. There was this personal relation. There was this relation of trust. You knew you could trust the other person because he or she was doing a good scientific job. But what data archives, and I think you can also generalize this to data producers, what they are doing is that they are depersonalizing these trust relationships. This slide is showing the same argument with a slightly different picture. You have this circle of trust. People are within the circle of trust, exchanging thoughts, exchanging data, working together. And then now you have more or less open data archives, and you have hundreds of people going there, and the communities opened up. But Frank Sposito's argument was that data providers and data producers and archives might have to think about ways of re-establishing this trust and re-personalizing data and data relationships. How much time do I still have?
2 minutes.
So this slide is just providing a glimpse of an Austrian strategy that we have developed in the last 2 years with the Austrian research community, how we can improve conditions for social sciences in Austria, how we can improve the framework conditions. And some of the measures we take are going also in the direction of supporting research infrastructures. And I think the last one is some very small thing, actually, but it's interesting. It's the Austrian Research Infrastructures Data Bank. The idea was that people that want to cooperate, also companies for the natural and engineering sciences, don't often know what infrastructures exist and whether they can use them or not. So you put them in a database and there they can look for it. And we recently looked at the database whether SSH research infrastructures were there, and there were basically none. Those that were checked as SSH were from psychology, but it was rather natural sciences psychology. So we thought, well, first it's an indication that research infrastructures from the social sciences and humanities sometimes don't consider them research infrastructures, especially if they are classical archives or collections, but they are. And so we started to simply tell them, you know, register in the database, and that's now what is happening. So, last slide. Well, these ticks are maybe a little bit too ambitious. Scientific demand checked, societal demand checked. It's not that simple, but I have quickly touched upon it. But what I wanted to say is that in societal demand, I think there is even more potential for the use. And actually, yesterday I heard an interesting argument that natural science research infrastructures are nervous when they have to show, or when they learn that they have to show their societal impact. And then the argument was that actually it's also the other way around. But I think actually the natural sciences research infrastructures really have to be a little bit more nervous than SSH research infrastructures when it comes to societal impact, and now vice versa, societal demand. So, because I'm a little bit over time, I just want to say thank you, and see you in Vienna, maybe, because we will host, during the Austrian presidency, EU Council presidency in the second half of this year, the ICRI conference. Some of you might have received a save the date email, because I was putting, I think, 300 SSH research infrastructure people on the save the date list. And then we have a conference specifically on the question of impact of social sciences and humanities that has the aim to discuss the notion, the concept of impact together with the European Commission in order to further develop the concept of impact for a practical use in FP9. And this will be at the height of FP9 negotiations, because they will accumulate in the second half of this year. Thank you.
Thank you, Matthias.